मिलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। श्री चैतन्य मनोविष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वापदान्तिकम्। वन्देहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सगण रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सह गणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। हे कृष्णा करुणा सिन्धो दीनबन्धो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिकाकान्त राधाकान्त नमोऽस्तुते। तप्त काञ्चन गौराङ्गी राधे वृन्दावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये। वाञ्छकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिन्धुभ्येव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। सो वी वेलकम एवरीवन टू दिस ऑनगोइंग कंटिन्यूइंग सेशंस ऑन द 24 गुरुज ऑफ दत्तात्रेय, ऑल्सो कॉल्ड इन द श्रीमद् भागवतम एज द सॉन्ग ऑफ द अवधूत ब्राह्मण। As we have already seen, the first five principal gurus of Dattatreya, he is having a conversation with Yadu, the principal chief king of the Yadu dynasty, after whom the Yadu dynasty has come in place. So, devotees, he is having this conversation with Yadu, and he is mentioning how by the rationalized intelligence, one can observe the mother nature and take spiritual masters. And he is explaining how 24 different spiritual masters are being observed from mother nature. So the first five he spoke about. So anybody can tell me the first five, who was the first number one spiritual master whom he spoke about? You all gave very nice verses. I received also verses of the previous thing. One of them is Vayu, but the first one was Earth. Pranav is absolutely correct. The first one was Earth. Who was the second one? Water. Okay. Second was Air, Vayu, Water. And then fourth was Bhumi Rapo Nalo Vayu. Yes, Fire. So we saw Fire and we also saw Sky. So we saw five of them. So today is sixth spiritual master that we are going to see. So we saw different elements of their glorification. So today, it's a very beautiful, and we'll talk about only one spiritual master today because the subject matter is pretty vast. And the sixth spiritual master that the Dattatreya or the Avadhuta Brahmana speaks about is the moon. What a wonderful day that we are speaking about the moon. And the seventh spiritual master is the sun. And today is the solar eclipse, where for the first half of the entire day, we have been watching this play of the moon, earth, and the sun. And today, Krishna's wish that it so happened that we have to speak about the moon is that the person in the moon is the one who is actually eclipsing or coming in between the, as per the scientists, they say, it's coming in between the sun and the earth. And it seems as if it is engulfing the sun. But the Vedic Shastras also speak about Rahu, who is also a principal dead planet, which is there in the mention of the Vedic scriptures. Dead planet means the light is not reflected from that planet. So there is a dead planet called as Rahu, which also comes in between and causes this eclipse. So scientists and Vedic principles both say the same thing, though they have different nominations. So what a good day, though the eclipse is generally considered as not that purificatory for the Vedic science. But it is a great science to learn about such events and remember about the Lord, because that is what Avadhuta Brahmana is doing. So today we will learn about the moon, and we will see how Krishna has very lovingly come in Chandra Vamsha, in the dynasty of the moon. And we will see some nice shlokas, how Krishna relates with the moon as well. So without much further ado, let us go. Today I have some slides also with me, which I will share. So let me know when you can see the screen. Let me know when you can see the screen. Yes. Can you see the screen now? If yes, please type in yes. Are you able to see? Yes, okay, perfect. So let's go back to the screen and let's read the first shloka. This is from Srimad Bhagavatam, where he is mentioning about the moon. So let's read this shloka. Visargya smashananta bhavadehasya natmana kalanamiva chandrasya kalena vyakta vartamana. So here he is saying the various phases of one's material life, beginning with birth and culminating in death. Bhava dehasya natmana. So beginning with birth and culminating in death are all properties of the body and do not affect the soul. Just as the apparent waxing and waning of the moon does not affect the moon itself. Such changes are enforced by the imperceptible movements of time. So seems like a very tough verse, but it is very simply put together. The Avadhuta Brahmana is saying that the soul is permanent and does not undergo any change, which we have learned in the Bhagavad Gita very clearly, that the soul does not undergo any change. The soul is as it is, right? So what happens is that, just stopping my presentation. Okay. So what happens is that when the Avadhuta Brahmana is saying very clearly that the soul does not undergo any change, even in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that the soul is eternal in nature. It does not undergo any change. What undergoes change then? What is the thing that undergoes changes? Vasamsi jirnani yata vihaya. The body. The body undergoes changes. And the body is the one which constantly undergoes the changes. So here the comparison is given to say, just like the waxing and waning of the moon. What is called waxing and waning? We see in the first 15 days from Amavasya to Purnima, every day the Chandra or the moon is only able to be seen partially. On the Purnima day, you can see a full moon. Afterwards, for the next 15 days, it will constantly wane and wax. That is the, what do you mean by waning and wax? It keeps lower and lower, it goes lower and lower, and we cannot see the full moon. You can only see half crescent, full crescent, a perfect crescent, a very thin crescent. So the moon undergoes this particular decrease and increasing, waxing and waning is what we say. And this is what we undergo or we see in the moon. But when this is happening to our eyes, is the real moon which is there, the moon which is there in the astronomical sky, is it actually depleting, increasing and decreasing? Is it that we are seeing it, or is it actually happening? Yes, it is not actually happening. It is as it is. But because of our relative movement, we see that this waxing and waning happens. What Dattatreya is trying to say here is, just like the moon is unaffected by this waxing and waning, which is perceivable to us, similarly, there are changes within this body which happens. What are the different changes that it happens? Shastras speak about six changes that happens within the body. The first thing is birth. Second is growth. That is the first change. From the birth to growth, there is a change. Then maintenance. We have to maintain this body, go to the gym, maintain the growth, eat healthy food. And when we eat healthy food, then the fourth change happens. We produce all byproducts. Sweat comes when you actually work out in the gym and try to grow the muscles. You all sweat. We eat nice palatable foods. We have to pass urine and stool. So all these byproducts are produced. So that is also a change which happens in the body. So birth, growth, maintenance, production of byproducts, and then the dip happens. This is all the peak form of the body. Dwindle away, and finally we meet with death. So these are the six changes that the body undergoes. But while this body undergoes these changes, the personality of the soul, which is there in the body, which is always residing in the heart, that does not undergo any change. So that is how this exactly this analogy is compared to. So when Dattatreya is actually watching the moon, he's saying, look at the moon. It is waxing and waning. It is increasing and decreasing. But the moon itself does not have any change. Similarly, by that keeping him as the spiritual master, I learned this tattva that the soul never undergoes any change. It is only the different bodies that we take. And when the different bodies as we take, it undergoes many changes. And the changes of birth, growth, maintenance, production of byproducts, dwindling and death. This is how he is actually comparing with the moon and learning. And this is what he is telling Yadu, that you should use the rationalized intelligence. So what does that mean? Next time we see the moon, we should also try to remember these shlokas. We should also try to remember that is how we actually remember Krishna's pastimes, Krishna's activities. So we will talk about that. Whenever we learn such things in Srimad Bhagavatam, these verses should be internalized. And next time when somebody talks about the moon, even our casual friend who is there in the college and says, hey, look, the moon seems to be very close to Earth. Sometimes it happens. In the event of super moon, the moon looks very close to Earth and it looks gigantic. Sometimes it looks very pink. Some people say, I can see a rabbit and a deer on the moon. They say like that. But whenever they say like that, we can say yes or no. But in the back of the mind, if we actually think about these shlokas of Bhagavatam, like how the sun is moving, how the moon is going, how this earth is tolerating, how the fire has latent heat in it, similarly are the sages. Like this, when we actually prod our intelligence, we become more purified. That is how we say Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya does not mean that always we have a book, Bhagavatam, and reading shlokas 24 hours. Internalizing, seeing everything connected to Krishna is also Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. You are thinking about Srimad Bhagavatam. And this Bhagavatam is such a scripture that it gives us this vision to see in a very beautiful way. So, here in the purport, Srila Prabhupada also mentions in this shloka that how Sridhar Swami and Jiva Goswami both have commented on the moon and the sun, because the next spiritual master is the sun. So they comment about that. Moon is generally, if you look at the scientific paradigm, they are trying to spend so much of money and go to moon and find out some rocks and come back and trying to find out if it contains water or not. But as per Jiva Goswami and Sridhar Goswami, who are actually the epitome of astronomical science, and they have given this understanding that moon is generally a watery planet. Of course, we are not able to see water, but there are now the scientists have found out from Chandrayaan and many other places that there are ice caps on the moon and there is plenty of water beneath the surface. But our shastras have been always saying that the moon is a watery planet, whereas the sun is a very fiery, fiery planet. So this is the understanding that they give. What is the use of the moon in our natural day-to-day life? If there is no moonlight, which is actually a reflection of the sunlight, moon itself does not have a shine. But the moon captures the light of the sun and reflects it onto Mother Earth. And this reflection is a little more cooler. So that's why they say always all these pastimes between Radha and Krishna, you will see a moon in behind, because those moonlit shades adds to the romantic as well as the wonderful feeling of the pastimes. It's very cool, it is very calm, and because of that moonlight, Srimad Bhagavatam says all our sabjis, vegetables, fruits, whatever is growing in this mother nature, they get the real juiciness, the taste. The taste is not developed by the sunlight. The taste is developed by the moon and the moonlight. So sunlight is important for growth, but moonlight is important for these vegetables and fruits to give that juiciness, fibrous tenderness, and those tastes in those sabjis and vegetables and fruits. So moon plays a very important part. So next time we think about moon, we can think about the spirit soul, we can think about how Krishna has created this moon in such a nice way that it is actually enduring us to give all these particular forms. So it's a very simple shloka, but let us now go between the connection between Krishna and the moon, and that is where the rasa comes, and that is where the beauty comes. So let me present my screen again. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, there is a shloka which comes, and let's talk about that. This is told by Garga Muni. So this is in the 10th canto, 8th chapter, 15th verse. Here, Garga Muni is actually telling to Nanda Maharaj. What is he saying? He has come to his house because he was sent by Vasudev, and he said that my son has crossed 100 years in Vrindavan. So generally after 100 years, he should be given a Namankaran. That means his naming ceremony has to happen. So Garga Muni has come to Vrindavan and he has given names to Krishna. He has not told Krishna directly. He has called him the Dark One, Shama, and he has also called him Vasudev. So he has called, give him two names, Krishna and, you know, Vasudev. But then he says this shloka. What is this shloka? Let's read it. Bahuni santi namani rupani cha sutasyate guna karmanu rupani tani aham veda na jana veda no jana. He says, who is saying this? Garga Muni, Gargacharya is saying. To whom is he saying? To Nanda Maharaj. He's saying, for this son of yours, Bahuni Santi Namani. Bahuni means many. Santi, there are. Santi means are. Namani, many names. Rupani Chasutasyate. This son of yours, there are many forms and names. Now please note here that there is a very, very important word here. And what is that word? I have marked it in a different color. It is purposefully done. What is that word? If you can see the slide, can you tell me which word is marked in a different color? Anybody else? What is that word we have marked? Santi. Santi, correct. Santi in English language translates to there are. So if you actually see this, this particular letter R is the direct meaning of this word called as Santi. In fact, when we read Srimad Bhagavatam, we would just skip it as one of those connecting words. But a very great Siddhanta, a very great matter is actually hidden in this simple word called as R. Let's actually learn this Siddhanta. So, Bahuni Santi Namani Rupani cha sutasyate guna karma nurupani tanyaham vedano jana. He says, your son has many forms and names according to his transcendental qualities and activities. Guna is the first word, karma is the second word. So guna means quality, karma means activity. And he's saying all these names are connected to guna, and these names are connected to karma, his activities. So let us learn this very nicely, that what are his names, and I want some examples from you guys. What are Krishna's names which are based on his guna, on his quality? And So let's first talk about it. Can you give me some examples of certain examples where Krishna is, okay, let's go one by one. So we are getting these answers, okay? So first one is Gauranga. So he is of golden color. Okay. That is a physical form, but his quality, yes, okay, we can. Shama Sundar. Okay, he is of Sham and he is beautiful in nature. More, which exhibits, yes, very nice. Bhakta Vatsala, very dear to devotees. In fact, this example is exactly given by Jiva Goswami. When he actually mentions this example, he actually is Aparajit. Yes, absolutely, very nice. Yathotakari, yes, correct. Madan Mohan, Govinda, absolutely, yes. Okay, we have got plenty of examples. All these are names of qualities. Bhakta Vatsala. Now, all these qualities are mentioned by Krishna, where his qualities do come. Bhakta Vatsala, and he is known as Aparijit. All these are different examples. Another thing is Dinabandhu. He is actually the friend of the distressed. So these are very dear examples. So now let us talk about Karma Rupani. That is, his activities wise, what are the names given to Krishna? Anybody? Due to his activities. Giridhari, absolutely wonderful name. Giridhari means he is the lifter of Govardhan. Govinda is the protector of cows, right? Madhusudana, he actually is the killer of the Madhu demon. Murari, he is the killer of the Mura demon, right? So many wonderful activities that he has performed. Partha Sarathi, what a beautiful name. He became the Sarathi for Partha. So very good. All these examples are wonderful examples where his karma or his karma rupani, his activities are having. So now let us go back to the presentation where you will see. Let me see, just a second. Let me see if I can use this window. Yes. So if you can look at this. So here he is saying, Bahuni Santi Namani, and he is saying that Bahuni Santi Namani. So these are Gunakarmani Rupani. Tanyam Tanyaham Tani Aham. That means I know this. Who is saying this? Gargacharya says, I know all these names, but people in general do not understand them. So that means he is saying, I know all these names, but devotees, the most important word, as I said, is Santi. What does that mean? Santi means there are. That means as he is now known as Vasudev, at this same point of time, he is known as Bhaktavatsala. At the same point of time, he is known as Dinabandhu. At this same point of time, though he is born right now and he has not lifted Govardhan, he is still known as Govardhan Giridhari. He is still known as Draupadi Rakshaka. He is still known as Bhakta Vatsala. That means at any given point of time, Krishna has many names. This is not the case for us. For example, when we are a student, then only you can call us as a student. When we go to a college, we can go say that you have gone to a college. When we are married, you can say that we have been married by our activities. Or when we become intelligent, then only you can call us as intelligent. But this is not the tattva for Krishna. Krishna is simultaneously Girivaradhari, Radha Madan Mohan, Radha Madhav. He is also Bhakta Vatsala. He is also Draupadi Rakshaka. And that is what this word is saying as R. There are many forms, and that is what Garga Muni is saying very, very secretly, that these are known to me, but people in general do not understand them. So this is a very great Siddhanta, that currently there are many names which are present, and there are currently, at this given point of time when he has actually born, there are currently many, many forms that he is currently taking also. Now, this is not told by my imagination or Gargacharya's imagination. This is actually mentioned by Bhakti Vinod Thakur. And it was very wonderful that today everything got arranged. And that is why I really like this day today. Today is the eclipse. We are talking about the moon. And we have talking about the connection between Krishna and the moon. And we are talking about a verse where Garuda Muni says Krishna has all the names simultaneously present. And there is a very beautiful shloka, actually very beautiful purport given by Bhakti Vinod Thakur in his Krishna Samhita, in his seventh chapter. He says, Krishna is stealing the gopi's clothes in another devotee's heart. He is performing the rasa dance in someone's heart. He is killing putana in another's heart. He is killing skamsa in someone else's heart. He is having an affair with kubja in yet another devotee's heart. He enacts his disappearance in the heart of some devotee who is leaving his body. As the living entities are innumerable, the planets are also innumerable. As one pastime takes place on one planet, another pastime takes place on another planet. In this way, each pastime continuously takes place. Therefore, all of the Lord's pastimes are eternal. There is no break. This is what Bhaktivinoda Thakur, who is actually today we are celebrating, and that is what he says. So whenever sometimes in the lectures you hear that multi-universe theory, in this universe, this pastime is taking place. In some other universe, some other pastime is taking place. Jovially, many people say in Krishna consciousness, always when some question is not answered or some leela is not answered, they give this answer. And when you ask a Shastric Praman, we actually go finding for it. The Shastric Praman is given by Bhaktivinoda Thakur in Krishna Samhita. So he actually says this very nicely. So what does this say? This says that Krishna does his pastimes simultaneously. And we see this in a very beautiful way, because Gargacharya says that not everybody understands this in pure totality. Even we see that in Narada Muni, when he went to Dwaraka, he got baffled by seeing 16,108 Krishnas in 16,108 palaces. Why was he baffled? Narada Muni is such a great devotee. Why should he become flabbergasted? Why should he become so surprised? And the answer given is, Narada Muni saw Krishna appearing in front of one Vasudeva and one Devaki. But he did not see 16,108 Krishnas appearing from 16,108 Vasudevas and Devaki. That he did not see. Second, he knows that by Yoga Siddhi, that one person can become eight in nature. But 16,108 is something which is very, very unnatural and unseen before. Even in the Yoga Siddhi, when a person, one becomes eight in nature, everything what one person does, the other eight will do the same thing. Suppose one person raises the left hand, all the eight will raise the left hand. Such was not the case with Krishna in his 16,108 forms. It was not robotic movements which were there in Dwaraka. Krishna was 16,108 independently acting in 16,108 palaces with his 10 sons each. He was acting as a perfect householder, a perfect husband, going out, bringing sabjis, taking care, everything he was doing perfectly. So that was very bewildering even for none other than Narada Muni. So Narada Muni was also thinking, how is this possible? So if we look at this shloka, Bahuni Santi Namani, the word Santi is most important. And our acharyas are so wonderful. They connect this most important tattva of that Krishna is simultaneously known as Girivardhari, Bhaktavatsala, everything to none other than the moon. And that is why we are trying to talk about here. So let's just go to that beautiful verse where the connection is there in Srimad Bhagavatam between this important verse and the next verse, which is also in Srimad Bhagavatam, but you have to go back a little chapters behind. It is called the 10th canto, 3rd chapter, 8th verse. And let's look at that verse. Devakyam deva rupinyam Vishnu sarva guhashaya avirasid yatha prachyam dishindur iva pushkala. The last letters are the most important. Dish Indur Eva Pushkalaha. Then the Supreme Personality of Godhead Vishnu, who is situated in the core of everyone's heart, appeared from the heart of Devaki in the dense darkness of the night, like the full moon rising on the eastern horizon, because Devaki was of the same category as Sri Krishna. So here he's saying that Lord appeared from the heart of Devaki, just like Disha Indur Eva Pushkalaha. That means that he appeared, the full moon was rising from the eastern horizon. So when you actually see this, why is this example given of the moon? Just like in the eastern horizon, when the moon is rising, does not mean that the moon is only available in the eastern horizon. Maybe in the western horizon, it is going to set and the sun is going to come up. So while this appearance and disappearance of the moon might be local to one position, but the moon itself is appearing and disappearing all over the world at many different point of time. Again, mentioning the same point, what Gargacharya is saying, Bahuni Santi Namani. At the same time, there are many forms, many activities. Just like today's solar eclipse example. When it was happening in Sidi, Haryana, the totality was happening, the eclipse and the diamond ring was coming. In Saudi Arabia, the eclipse was just starting. Whereas in Northern America, the eclipse had not even started. Does not mean that the eclipse is not happening. As the earth is relatively moving, we get to see this eclipse at different points of time, and the sutak time also changes differently. Similarly, in this verse, just like the moon appears in the Disha Indur Eva Pushkalaha, just like the moon is appearing at the eastern horizon, Krishna has now appeared from the heart of Devaki. That is what Srimad Bhagavatam is saying. So again, this same verse is given as a comparison between the moon. And it is this moon that Dattatreya is looking at. And he is remembering Krishna. And Krishna himself is instructing these verses to Uddhava. Look at the nectar where moon is present in everything. He is the moon of the Chandravamsha. He's the presiding lord of the entire universe, and he's taking this example from this eastern moon. So we see this Devakyam Devarupinyam Vishnu Sarva Guhashayaha Avirasidyata Pratyam Disha Indur Eva Pushkalaha. So next time we see the moon is rising in the sky, we should actually remember this shloka, where Srimad Bhagavatam is very beautifully saying that in the dense darkness of night, like the full moon is rising on the eastern horizon, Devaki was of the same category as Krishna. So this is a beautiful verse that it is saying. So now let us see two more verses of how Krishna and the moon are together. So in this, when Krishna is actually born, or Krishna is actually appearing in this material world, then what generally happens is that we see many acharyas are very eager to speak about what Krishna is doing, what he did. Till this time, they were just waiting for the fact that when Krishna will appear and when will we glorify him. So here, when Krishna has appeared with this verse, then many acharyas take this example forward and they mention about what were the activities of Krishna when he actually appeared and he started crawling on the ground. And after crawling, sometimes he used to speak stutter some words in front of his mother and father. And he used to speak like babies. Sometimes when there are young babies crawling on the floor, and when you can speak to them all day and they will speak all gibberish back to you. They'll just say some words. They will mention it here and there. And it'll be very joyful for the parents. So Krishna also was giving a lot of joy to his parents by saying many different words coming out of his mouth. And let's just look at some of the words that he mentioned to his parents. Who are his parents? None other than Nanda and Yashoda. So let's just look at these verses. This is in Gopala Champu. Very beautiful verse where he says, Mama Tata Iti Vacha Patan Nanda Tanujani Anandhartam Abhut Pitror Vrajasya Nikhilasya Cha. So look at the first verse. Mama, like some babies are reciting this. Mama, tata, no meaning. But here the acharyas are saying Krishna is actually talking to Yashoda Maiya and Nanda Maharaj. Ma means mother, and even if you put those two words together, mama and tata, tata means tat means tat. Ta, and if you put the first ta and the second words t together, you will get tat. That means he's saying mother, father. Like that, he's calling his mother and father out, being in the lap of Mother Yashoda. Mama tata iti vacha. Vacha means sounds. He's making such sounds. Patan Nanda Tanujani, like that Nanda's Tanujani, the young darling child of Nanda, is actually saying these words. But by saying this, what is he giving? Anandartham abut pitror. To his parents, he is giving unlimited amount of joy. And not only to the parents, Vrajasya Nikilasya cha, even to the Vrajvasis, he is giving so unlimited amount of joy. And then Mother Yashoda thinks, let us look at this moon-like boy. Let me keep him on my lap and let me ask him some questions. So Jiva Goswami is saying in Gopala Champu, Ishita kim jagatya. So Yashoda Maya is asking Krishna, Ishita kim jagatya? Will you protect this earth? Will you protect the people of this earth? This is the question. And what does the child say? The child does not know to speak. Krishna does not know to speak. So he says, So he is just saying. And then Yashoda Maya asks, Bandhun pashyasi nakim? Will you not protect your own kith and kin? And Krishna says, But actually, Jiva Goswami gives a very beautiful explanation that Krishna is not speaking Krishna is saying Om. Krishna is saying Om. Ishita kim jagatya Om. Bandhun pashyasina kim Om. So the Supreme Personality of Godhead seems like he is saying to his mom and dad, but he is actually saying the pranavakar, the Omkar, the very Om. And such is the beautiful realization. So mother is supremely happy that my child is saying so nice words. And then she immediately, happily, she wants to ask something. And this is when Kavi Karnapura gives this beautiful relationship between the moon and Krishna. So what is that relation? Here, if you actually see the verse is very clearly mentioning about how Ananda Vrindavana Champu, Kavi Karnapura, here Mother Yashoda is saying, asking this question to Krishna. Kim shiram nam, kim shiram, shiram means milk. Do you want good milk, Krishna? Kim means do you? Because Krishna started crying, being on the lap of the Mother Yashoda. He was crying vehemently. Many people were trying to stop him, but nobody was able to stop him. So mother started asking, why are you crying, Lala? What do you want? And the first question she asked is, Kim Shiram? Shiram means milk. Do you want milk? And what does Krishna say? Na. No, I don't want milk. Kim Uttamam Dadi? Do you want the best curd? Krishna says, No, I don't want that also. Little boy in the lap of mother is very expert in saying what he wants and what he does not want. Kim kurchika varana. So this is actually read in the Sad Goswami Ashtaka kind of a meter. Kim shiram na kim uttamam dadinano. Kim kurchika varana. Varana na. I don't want that also. Miksha kim. Do you want nice amiksha? Or amiksha is generally known as, this chena, which actually these Bengalis used for all this rasgulla and everything. They used chena. Miksha kim nana. No, I don't want any chena. Kim tave pishitam ahau hayanga vinnam daram. So what do you want? Krishna, you don't want milk. You don't want good amount of curd. You don't want nice yogurt. You don't want this chena. What do you want? Then Krishna says, Dasya mona vishida vatsa nataram kupyasva matre gruhot panne no ruchirit udanguli dala sitam shumalokayat. So Krishna says, I am really angry because I want something. So Mother Yashoda is saying, why are you angry? Why are you, what, why is that you are angry? We will give you all that you want. So Krishna says, Kupasya matre grihotpanne no ruchir. He says, actually, I want a butterball. So Mother Yashoda says, you want a butterball? No problem, we will get it from our house. But Krishna says, grihetpanne no ruchir. I have no interest in the butterball which is made in our house. Then Mother Yashoda is thinking, what is he talking about? Then he, Aud Anguli Dala, he uses his finger and points outside his house and shows the moon. Sitam Shumalokaya. He says, I don't want the butterball which is inside the house over the matka, which you can actually see here. He says, I don't want this butterball. I want this butterball which is outside the house. I want the moon. That's what he says. And Mother Yashoda says, how can we get the moon for you? And the minute she says, I cannot get the moon for you, Krishna starts to cry again. So our acharyas are so expert, so wonderful, that they know the way to actually connect the beautiful topics. And Krishna is actually looking at the moon and he's saying, I want this moon. I want to get this moon. So these are the wonderful pastimes when Krishna is interacting with Mother Yashoda, asking for the moon. And finally she says, I know I cannot get the moon. So she puts a mirror in front and the reflection of the moon comes. And that's where you can see the photo when Krishna is actually trying to reach, and because he thinks this is the softest, biggest butterball in which he can dive into, swim and eat to his relishment. Such is the beautiful pastimes of the Lord. And Dattatreya is actually relishing all these, but here he is just mentioning because he is at the avaduta level. He is just seeing the moon and saying this is a spirit soul, and then this is absolute spirit soul, and here the soul does not change, just like the moon does not change, only the body changes. So this is the meaning that we will learn today. This is a beautiful verses from Srimad Bhagavatam where this moon is there. So my humble request to all of you is, when you do your research, please see the research from this angle, that how Krishna and the moon were coming together, what is the examples that the moon were given, and such are the verses that we have to collect for our books. Imagine such verses when a person reads the moon, reads the realization. I am very, very sure, 100%, that when we actually look at these verses and when we put it in our brain and we revisit it, every time we see the moon, it will only be Bhagavatam which will come in front of our eyes. And that is perfection of life. So here, Kavi Karnapura and Jiva Goswami says, let this effulgence, whatever is the effulgence coming out of this moon, let that protect you. Now, many places in Srimad Bhagavatam and others, we hear these words that let the arms protect you, let the legs protect you, let these pastimes protect you. And we might be thinking, how this effulgence or how this butterball called as the moon is going to protect us? It is going to protect us, my dear devotees, only when we are at the deathbed, even when we actually think about these pastimes, then these pastimes help us to protect ourselves from the darkest mode of ignorance, which is due to our own mental speculations, and it protects us from death itself. And that is the greatest protection that Krishna gives by reciting these Bhagavatam shlokas. So here today, we'll just conclude here by saying that the Avadhuta Brahmana actually spoke about the moon, where he compares us to the spirit soul, which is unchanging, but the bodies undergo six kinds of change, just like the waxing and the waning of the moon happens in front of our eyes, but the moon itself does not undergo any change. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Granth Raj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Nitai Gaur Premanande Hari Hari Bol. If there are any questions, comments, we can discuss. Hare Krishna. Any questions, comments? You can unmute yourself and also speak if you want, if typing is difficult.
I have a question.
Yeah, please go ahead.
प्रभुजी नारद मुनि न्यू दैट कृष्णा इज द सुप्रीम पर्सनालिटी ऑफ गॉड हेड देन व्हाई वाज ही शॉक्ड सीइंग कृष्णा इन 16,108 डिफरेंट फॉर्म्स इन
So,
फॉर्म्स
yeah. So, because Narad Muni's principal rasa is of Dasya and also Sakya. These are the principal rasas that Narad Muni operates on. But when he actually saw with the servital mood, he understands that Krishna can do these awe and reverence activities. Now, Aishwarya is something that is available in Dwaraka in the maximum level, but not in Vrindavan. Vrindavan Krishna is in a different form in itself. Aishwarya does not find a place in Vrindavan. So when Narada Muni actually saw that, he physically in front of his eyes, he did see that Krishna appeared and before Devaki and Vasudev in the Karagar. So he was very clear that one Krishna is there. And he knew that Krishna can expand himself. But he couldn't even imagine this fact that Krishna was acting independently in each of these houses. That is the greatness of the Lord. So the Lord's activities are equally bewildering even for devotees. Even for devotees. And the Lord is capable of bewildering even the devotees. And that's what Kunti Maharani also says. I am totally bewildered by your pastimes. I'm totally bewildered. I can't even imagine how your invisible hand works in protecting us. You protected us from Lakshagra. You protected us from the poison. You protected us in the great battle of Kurukshetra. You protected Uttara from the Brahmastra. How do you do this? It's very bewildering for us to know. Even the cowherd boys, they were bewildered when they saw Bakasur in front of them and how Krishna swallowed Bakasur, and so many demigods were trying to hit Bakasur. So sometimes Krishna puts even the greatest of the devotees in bewilderment just to increase the rasa and the pastime, and also to drive home a point that Krishna is Abhijnana Swarat. He is absolutely independent. He is not dependent upon anyone. So to drive home this point also, sometimes he shows these pastimes. So Narada here was bewildered because of that. Hope that answers the question. Any other question? Okay, if no other questions, then you are all ready to go and find out the verses for yourself on moon, a little subject matter which is to be found. So please continue your search, and we will all meet next week to talk about another beautiful subject which we saw today in the eclipse, none other than the seventh spiritual master that the Avadhuta Brahmana speaks about is none other than the sun. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Granth Raj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Nitai Gaur Premanande. Hari Hari Bol. Hare Krishna.